Дорогие друзья.
Dear friends, a very good morning. Let us start.
Friends, colleagues, glad to see you in Moscow at our event. Let's start. Вы знаете, у нас...
You know, I've been present at the first panel and I saw everybody with very serious faces following the discussion. I can assure you our discussion will be no less serious. However, I invite you all to relax a little bit and maybe wake up your fantasies. So we'll be talking about the age of great disruption, the time when all the traditional norms and values we're used to are being broken and replaced by new ones, being challenged. Stereotypes are being replaced by new solutions, new type of thinking, new technologies. How quickly should we change to stay on par with time? Not just remain in this profession, but grow and develop this profession and our competences, and therefore support the efficiency of public administration and achievement of national objectives. Don't you think it might be the case that many of the professions already tomorrow might change overnight, including the professions of an auditor, or maybe some professions would simply cease to exist? So this is what I'd like to invite you to talk about. It is my pleasure to introduce our distinguished speakers, Herman Greffer, the chairman and executive board and the president of Sberbank, Sergei Sobyanin, mayor of Moscow, Philippe Proje, regional vice president in Microsoft for Central and Eastern Europe, and Augusta Lopez Claras, director of the Global Indicators Group at the World Bank from 2011 to 2017, and the former chief economist of the World Economic Forum, the chairman of the Global Governance Forum. Your applause. And myself, Roman Plusev, the news presenter at TV channel Russia 24, and a moderator of today's discussion. So, it's not possible to develop the standards for all possible situations of life. However, we do see that the world is changing so rapidly, the processes are changing. Very frequently, the level of uncertainty is very high, and nonetheless, we need to work efficiently. In particular, that is applicable to the Supreme Audit institutions. We need to contribute to enhance the efficiency of this public administration and achievement of national objectives. Are there standards for out-of-the-ordinary situations? Is that possible? That is my question to all of you. As a moderator, I'd like to share with you the situation that I'm lucky to be an inborn Moscovite. I live in Moscow, I'm a customer of Sberbank, and I know what disruption is about. I got to feel disrupt technologies every single day. Just this morning, I opened up a mobile app on Moscow Transport, and I can actually keep track of a bus moving in Moscow and know exactly at what time the bus will stop at the bus stop nearest to my home, and I go exactly when it comes there. Is that disruptive technology? Yes, for sure, if you think of what we had several years ago. I'm a customer of Sberbank, and today in my mobile phone I can keep track of all my finances in an online mode, and I no longer carry a purse with me. I simply use my smartphone in order to pay for anything. That is disruptive for sure. And I was just telling Mr. May that my latest shock for me was that when my son went to school, and it's the first time when we didn't have to buy a diary for him, where everybody would put on the marks at school. And this is the document that would be carried in schools for 150 years in Russia. And this document has been in existence for the last century. And just think of it, this is the first time that children went to school without those registers on paper to get their marks there. So that is a major breakthrough that we've seen. We see new solutions coming and disrupting the reality. So, my colleagues, the first question to you, and that would be a very short question that I'd like to invite you to answer concisely to you. Please choose the three key words or statements or sentences to describe the principles of sustainable development in the disrupt age. What does it have to be? It can be knowledge, it might be smartphones or maybe weapons. Mr. Lopez Claras, the first question over to you.
Thank you very much. And let me begin by saying how happy I am to be with you today. And in particular, I find the flags on the tables to be a very nice symbol for this present age, especially ahead of the 75th anniversary of the creation of the United Nations. The three words that come quickly to mind are the following: catastrophe, interdependence, and cooperation. And let me just elaborate very briefly why I have chosen these three words. In terms of catastrophe, I think it is essentially because we are facing a whole range of global catastrophic risks, some of which are of an existential nature. I think that the knowledge that we have accumulated over climate change and the likely consequences of climate change for the global economy in particular are really quite perturbing. I refer in particular to the rising sea levels, to biodiversity, to extreme weather and events and so on. And this is a great concern. But certainly climate change is not by any means the only catastrophic risk that we face over the next several years. In the previous session, many of the speakers mentioned the problem of inequality, which is no longer just an economic issue. It is quickly mutated into a political issue that, if it is allowed to continue, if the present trends of inequality continue in coming years, I think this has the potential to undermine our social and political order. And then, of course, you know, there is the ongoing problem of poverty. We have celebrated the progress made in reducing extreme poverty in the last 20, 30 years, but I want to remind you, the poverty line used by the World Bank is a very, very austere, very tight poverty line. If you actually raise it to something like $5.50, half of the world's population is characterized as poor. So we still have a huge challenge on this front.
Господин Лопес-Кларес, I'm sorry. Можем вернуться.
If I may, can we please get back to those three keywords? We will talk about poverty line, I promise. Can you bring back to those three keywords you mentioned, catastrophe and the second and the third one?
Right. Interdependence, basically. Let me remind you, in 2008, the global financial crisis began in the United States and mutated very quickly into a global financial crisis where, in fact, the most affected countries were those on the periphery. We are far more interdependent today than we have ever been in the past, and this calls for the third word, cooperation. We are not going to be able to solve any of these global problems that we face unless we design new mechanisms of international cooperation. And this, to me, is perhaps the most important challenge for the 21st century. How are we going to confront collectively, as an international community, the problems that we face today, like climate change, like inequality?
It's a very important message. Thank you. Сергей Семенович.
Mr. Mayor, over to you. The same question. We were talking about the 90s, one of the hardest periods in the history of Russia. I recall Moscow, and the three key words for the Moscow of the 90s for me would be that you have expensive Mercedes car and a thick gold chain on your neck. Luckily, those words have gone into the past. What are the key three trends for today in Moscow? Well, Roman, we've been talking about the fact that this forum is conducted every 3 years. And I think we could conduct this forum once every 600 years in one country. If you think of what was happening in Russia 600 years ago, Russia was a different state, a different country. It was called differently. Nonetheless, over those 600 years, the journey that our country has been through is huge. But still, it is not as disruptive as what has happened. If we think of the 600 years to come, I think the human nature will change. And the journey that we've covered in 600 years so far will be covered in about 70 to 80 years. And that demonstrates the speed of change. And certainly the key challenge for today is the speed of change. And the winner in this competitive fight and we all in this global competitive environment is the one who will be the faster one in decision-making process, who will be the fastest one to adopt to the modern changes and introduce new technologies. So fast decision-making. Yeah, I would say my first key trend is ability to overcome any type of biases or stereotypes. The second one would be daily focus on result and effectiveness in your work. And the third one, I would say political courage to implement all those new ideas, because it requires serious changes to legislation, to the decision-making process. We might have to abandon a lot of populistic policies and decisions, and certainly all of it takes courage and readiness to adopt to innovations. This is something that we would lose without. Thank you very much, Mr. Roger. Over to you. Certainly in your company, in Microsoft, you've probably developed all those key positions.
Thank you for the invitation. It's a privilege to be here with representatives of this fine profession from across the world. As a representative of a technology company, obviously, the last couple of decades and the last couple of years in particular have been extremely enlightening in terms of understanding what the opportunities that the technology provides and their application can actually provide, and what the key factors are that actually make a difference. This applies to the microeconomical level within companies, it applies to the macroeconomical level, but it even goes beyond that into sort of the societal layer. If I were to summarize sort of the three key components which to me will drive that impact, I think the first one would be opportunity. There are still those who see problems instead of opportunity. And I think with every major technological change, every major sort of looking at the Industrial Revolution, looking at where we are today, ultimately it's those, as you said, those who embrace the opportunity first who end up leapfrogging and who end up winning. So I think opportunity and an ability to see that would be number one. The second one is going to be about trust. Obviously, when we use this technology, we all have our personal stories, but we also read the newspapers and we see that only responsible use of technology and only responsible technology companies will make it in the end. A lot of people put a lot of trust into this technology, and if that is not our number one priority, I think sooner or later that tends to catch up with you. So building trust, and to be fair, this is not just a one company story. If our industry cannot collectively build on the trustworthy use of technology and the ethical application of it and what have you, I think we're doomed in capturing this opportunity. So opportunity, trust, and I think the third one is literacy. Our ability to collectively up-level and upskill for the digital age, for the jobs of tomorrow, the youth of tomorrow, our female colleagues of tomorrow, I think is the third shift that we need to really work on, is how do we collectively up-level ourselves and increase the digital literacy at an exponential rate.
Thank you very much. That is indeed very exciting. From catastrophes, we're moving on to opportunities. Very different perceptions. Mr. Greff, over to you. When I was preparing for this event, I put into a search engine, Age of Disruption, I saw a lot of articles that were written by you. Could that be that you coined this term, the Age of Disruption? What is your recommendation? How would it stay afloat and sustainable in the Age of Disruption? Thank you very much. Well, I believe this term was coined about 600 years ago. Well, you restrict us to the choice of just three keywords. Well, if you want to, you can choose more or less than three. Okay, let me follow the rule you've just selected. So I would say my first keyword would be optimism. I'm not going to talk about threats or catastrophes or risks. We all started with smiles and positives, although smiling in the hall full of auditors from all around the world is a bit of a fake smile, I would say. But still, The first thing I'd like to mention is optimism. And any type of catastrophes and risks, I would call them opportunities. If you do not perceive it as an opportunity to implement your potential, you already lose without the beginning of this competition. The second word from me is leadership. If you fail to be a leader in your own life, not even a leader in your family or in your company, you cannot succeed. For me, leadership in the modern world, you know, there is a term well known to all auditors, zero-based budgeting. Well, for me, that is zero-based beginning. Every single day, you start from the scratch. Forget about all the successes or failures of yesterday and begin from the scratch. That's the essence of leadership of today. And the third word from my side is lifelong learning. Lifelong learning until with every last day of your life. And those changes that we're talking about today force us to enhance our competences every single day. Mr. Graf, what kind of managerial decision could secure the predictability and sustainability of our development so we can overcome global and regional crises and disruption? Well, what kind of stability can we talk about in the constantly changing world? We cannot possibly predict the changes that will come. So my answer to your question would be the absolute flexibility and delegation of decision-making process, engagement of the broader scope of people in the decision-making process, and awareness of what is happening, the delegation of your authorities in the decision-making process. I'm sure the pyramid structures of decision-making process will be a thing of the past. So maximum flexibility in decision-making process. All right. Mr. Lopez Claris, over to you. You've worked in Russia, and we recall the 90s, one of the hardest periods in the history of Russia. In the 90s, you were the head of the IMF office in Moscow. I'm really curious to ask you as a moderator, if I may, I will ask a personal question. You are back in Moscow today. You've seen Moscow in the 90s. What were your brightest impressions from your visit? How has Moscow changed since the 90s? What were your first impressions, something that shocked or maybe surprised you?
I have to tell you that although I was here in the 1990s, I have been to Moscow many, many times. And therefore, the many changes that have taken place, even in the way that the city looks, you know, I have noticed gradually over time. So I'm not in the middle of a shock. Having been absent from Moscow, you know, 20 years, but I have been here frequently enough. And I think that as I was driving from the airport yesterday, one of the things that was perhaps most noticeable is the new infrastructure that has been built, which seems to me of a much higher quality than had been the case in the 1990s when I was living here. But if I could come back to the question that you raised, which Mr. Graf addressed, you know, there are two things that actually come to mind. One of them is, it seems to me that we need to be much better in terms of improving the quality of our public policies. And I'm not just talking about Russia, I'm talking about the world over. In order that we can prioritize our spending decisions, you know, in a much better way. Let me give you an example. A couple of years ago, the International Monetary Fund, the organization I worked for many years, published a report where they said that globally, we're spending $5.5 trillion every year subsidizing energy, you know, natural gas, gasoline, coal, electricity, and that these subsidies are essentially not only making climate change worse, they are actually making income inequality worse, because 60% of the benefits goes to the top 20% of the population. So here we have a public policy. It is being implemented in many of the countries in the world, including many of your countries, by the way. And this really is a very destructive policy. So this gives you an example of, you know, the scope that we have for improving the quality of our policies. The second point that I like to emphasize is that I think there is also a great deal of scope for improving the ability of our international institutions to respond to the challenges that we face. Let me give you an example. I have no doubt that during the next global financial crisis, and you can be sure that there will be one, I don't know when, but there will be one, we should make sure that the IMF is empowered to deal with the implications of that crisis. And I have to tell you, I don't think it is at the moment. It doesn't have adequate resources. It has a governance system that, in fact, makes it a very powerful organization for small countries which don't have any systemic implications for the global financial system, and that gives it very little power for the big countries where the big risks are located. So this needs to change in a fundamental way.
It's an important message.
I'd like to clarify. Are any particular managerial tools in place? Particular managerial solutions which can allow to overcome the crisis with minimal consequences? Should they apply to IMF? Should they apply to international institutions? Or they need to pay attention to their domestic resources?
I think that you know, we need to rethink our entire system of global governance. You know, this is basically a legacy of 1945, when the United Nations was created and its associated agencies were brought into being. And unfortunately, the world has changed dramatically in the last 70 years. But the principles on which these organizations were created have not really changed very much. And I think that there is this gap whereby they are not fully empowered to deal with the problems that we face. Let me give you an example. We don't have a global environmental authority, right? So policy in the area of climate change is being done in a very ad hoc way, you know, through voluntary arrangements, which everybody knows are not working. Emissions are rising, they are not falling, right? And so unless we jump ahead and anticipate and be more proactive in terms of rethinking our institutional global framework, we are going to be overwhelmed by crisis, and we are going to be responding to crisis rather than anticipating crisis, which is what we need to do.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much for your input. So, Mr. Sabanin, Moscow is a leader in terms of the adoption of information technologies, information communication technologies. Is the high quality of public administration connected with the adoption of these digital technologies, or are there any other approaches in place? This is kind of a discussion matter. What is an issue, the egg or a hen? So we've been discussing this idea at all the platforms. The state has always desired to centralize all the processes based on the information systems, information technologies, and many believe that the information system itself is bringing positive effects. But such approaches have some drawbacks. As the state information system starts to dictate the technology to manage at all the levels, killing the independence in decision-making process, the motivations for innovations at all the layers of management and administration, you always have to consider that the initial thing, from my perspective, should be goal-setting the technology of management, and after that, turning it to digital, digitalizing the whole system. Of course, the opportunity to adopt new technologies gives new opportunities, but goal setting and the management system should be at the backbone of the systems. To understand you right, there shouldn't be forced processes in place. It should be natural. You cannot force that. If you try to overlap new information technologies on an old system of management, you may have a very bizarre situation. Moscow is a global leader in e-public services, according to the United Nations. But if we started digitalization of this process based on old management structures, on the old management order, nothing would have come out of this. We had to change the whole system, the interaction between the federal, regional, and municipalities, the change of order in terms of timings. We had to give up additional licenses, applications, so on and so forth. It's a big work. The initial stage was necessary, and only after that, that should be the foundation for digitalization, and it gives additional impetus to the synergy of all these processes. And at the end of the day, instead of getting the licenses for weeks, Moscow has just spent a couple of minutes through their web portals or through special centers, spending about 10, 15 minutes to get that. This is the result which we have, was based on the change to the management system and adoption of the information technologies. The situation has changed drastically. Any passport, any foreign passport, driving license, can be done within several clicks through the internet. These are the new information technologies. Mr. Graf, in the banking sector, what is the situation like? First, you need to prepare the foundation, and then you need to adapt, or it might be different. How is it happening in the banking sector? You know, it seems to me that we are stepping aside from the essence of the whole discussion. We are going into particular things, which from my perspective are not interesting for the audience. We're going to lose our audience. If we are discussing the public administration, we need to go back to the issue of administration itself. What is management? What is administration itself? In any system of management, in any system of administration, there is a big, very important part, which is called to run. Everyday business, what we're doing on a daily basis, the process management. Every day, any entity, Microsoft, Chamber of Accounts, are doing routine work on a daily basis, making some decisions, issuing some licenses, conducting some audits. And this is the first layer. So globally, the world which we used to live in the past, this red tape, the process management, accounted for 90% of the whole activity of any manager, be it senior official or a top manager in a big corporate. The second part of this work is a project management. We need to seek projects in order to create new facilities. Either we build new buildings, either we create new information systems, so on and so forth. And the second part of the project management is changing the current processes, which is also process management. After the world started to change intensively, the role of this project management is increasing. After we saw new information technologies, we had such a notion as agility. This is interaction of technocrats with the workers in a particular industry who started to change the processes of our work. This is the second part. Be model or entity management. But now you've used this third term, disruption. This is a tiny element of this innovative activity. When we see new technologies, absolutely new technologies, disruptive technologies to old management system, to old business models, they used to be tiny ones. Now they are becoming bigger and bigger. So what is the problem connected with the public administration? We're talking about four industrial revolutions. The problem of public administration is that along with these four industrial revolutions, public administration stayed the same. It has a big process management, it lacks project management, and there is no innovation approach. You may ask the question, is it necessary to digitalize everything? The answer is yes, we need to do that. Mr. Sabanin says that first you need to digitalize everything, and then you need to break the old model of management which we have. And this is the most second important step, implying the second expansion of the project management and shifting of state authorities to agility, as all the changes should be done within the current digital technologies. We need to give the impetus to the third part, which is innovations or disruptive technologies. I've never heard that within any state agency or state body there are some innovative specialists creating a new model of management. If you ask a Microsoft company, you may ask the question, how many people are responsible for the artificial intelligence? He would say that 5,000 people working for artificial intelligence in one corporate. If you ask me, I have 1,100 people doing that. How many people are doing that within the Chamber of Accounts or the government of the Russian Federation? The answer is in that. So the question, what is the evolution of this public administration? We are at the forefront of necessity to conduct the first revolution of the public administration. See, the fourth industrial revolution made it possible to create new technologies. Now it forces all the states to conduct the first revolution of the public administration. In order to change the current processes, the process management, to expand the range of those officials looking into the changes to the project management and start adopting innovations and disruptive technologies. So the motto of the fourth industrial revolution is run, agile, and disrupt, correct? Is the motto of the first revolution of this public administration, actually. Mr. Graf, you were to mention, I'd like to talk about the staff, and I'd like to ask Mr. Rajeshin how digital technologies should be combined with humanitarian algorithms. So what is the proportion of new technologies and skill and competences development among this staff? How should we train people? How should we pay attention to this staff, to regular people? I would like to ask you the question, as in your Moscow office, you appointed a new president, Ms. Tikhonova. She is with us. And I really liked how you introduced her.
Say, if you think about where we are today in our usage of technology, I think obviously, and Herman pointed to that, I think very fairly, we are obviously at the cusp of this fourth industrial revolution, and I think it forces us to rethink some of the paradigms of the, you know, business as usual evolution. I think lots of good points have been made. What I would say is, where we are today, and with this prevalence of digital technology, I think the one concept which today is making a difference, and we've seen this in our own company, but we also see this with the many clients we work with, is the democratization of technology. Ultimately, our ability to collectively put the tools, which have obviously evolved at an exponential pace over the last couple of years, but put the tools in the hands of all of your people, of all of your auditors, versus having very niche, very expensive, very high-end, and almost inaccessible technology, which will have probably very powerful, but not very widespread application. So I would say the empowerment of our people and our ability, which obviously brings literacy along as well, our ability to now put that technology in the hands of many, if not all of our people, I think is the real impact. And so it is fascinating to think about the impact of technology, not just in terms of, you know, the actual underlying technological power and speed, but in the organization's culture, in the people's literacy around that technology and in their applications of it. That, I think, is what's going to make a big difference. So empowering your organizations, empowering all of your people to use the technology, for me, is still the best way to uncover where these opportunities are. At Microsoft, we've been, you know, investing heavily over the last 30 years in artificial intelligence. And in the space of artificial intelligence, there is actually a period of about 10, 15 years, which is referred to as the AI winter, because not a lot of progress was made technologically. Now, after, you know, probably 40 or 50 years in that space, we finally come to a place where the technology is now powerful enough to be used. And so I often, maybe somewhat simplistically, but I often compare the current state of artificial intelligence with what, let's say, the spreadsheet would have been in the end of the 70s, beginning of the 80s, it was known to some. It was not seen as something that was going to be used by many. And look at where we are today. I think the real power is in our ability to put that technology in its simplest level in the hands of as many of our colleagues as we can, because believe me, they will know what data sets to look at. As a former corporate auditor myself, I've spent 5 years in two different companies as an internal auditor. I would argue that if we would had those types of technologies in the past, we would have been much more effective and much more efficient in actually, you know, gathering data, analyzing data, and basically drawing conclusions. In those days, we would obviously use databases and spreadsheets to understand where we are today. Well, the power of what's there today is obviously, exponential compared to what we used to have in the days. And so putting that technology in the hands of your people would be my one advice, my one recommendation. I think that is what's going to ultimately drive the benefits of this technology in society and obviously also in your profession.
Mr. Rajay, if I understand you right, you need to invest in artificial intelligence in regular people. You shouldn't invest in staff, in your specialists, or should it be proportioned in place?
We have a very strong belief that the technology we develop, unless it augments people's capabilities, is probably not worth investing in. So our philosophy is clearly to help individuals, help people do a better job through the use of technology, which is why we're investing in technologies like augmented reality for professionals who, you know, when they are doing complex tasks or in very hostile environments, get additional information, why the tools that we build are intended to be operated by real people and by individuals. And of course, there is this tension, make no mistake, there is this tension about replacing jobs with technology. The World Economic Forum, I think in one of its latest assessments, argued that 75 million jobs worldwide were at risk of replacement by technology, but that 133 million new positions with digital skills would be opened. And that 80% of the jobs, the new jobs which were going to be created between now and 2025, do not exist yet. So I think this is where you then need to start thinking about how do you upscale, skill your people, and how can we build a level of agility and flexibility in our organizations to make sure that we are actually at the forefront of identifying these skills and these jobs. And we try to do both. We try to make sure we invest a lot of time in skilling. We have a number of initiatives around the world and also in Russia. We also want to make sure that our technology is as accessible to as many people as we can. I think we have a reputation for simplifying technology and democratizing it. And then lastly, obviously, we also want to be supporting the development of these new roles at the high end to make sure that, you know, we can accompany organizations throughout that transition.
German Oskarovich.
Mr. Greff, is it worthwhile investing in people, or do we trust artificial intelligence? That's not an alternative. You know, there was this great Russian scientist who said that information exists in the noosphere, the knowledge sphere of the planet. You can't invest in technology purely, you invest in people. Could you be more specific? We implement technologies and let people adapt as best they can. Is that what you mean? Or let me put it like this. Do we need the people, the employees, that could work like this? Say two employees look at some materials to be audited, and one sees simply a matrix that is to be filled very quickly, and another looks at it and sees the prospects of what needs to be done. Like a good musician reading a sheet of music, hears the music rather than identifying individual squiggles. well, it takes all kinds, or, you know, all kinds of people. Humans are different. There are 7 billion of us, and everywhere you will hear the phrase, we lack people, we can't find the right people, and everybody wants the same kind of people, really. They're simply called by different names. D people or T people, that is, people who are experts in a particular area, but with a wide world view. It makes for a T shape. So somebody with lots of specialized knowledge and a lot of soft skills, the cognitive and social skills. We tried to define it for our organization. We tried to profile the kind of person we want to employ. And we singled out 3 competences that describe this person of the future. One, it is a highly creative individual. 2, it is an individual with systemic thinking. You must agree that somebody who is very creative and at the same time a systemic thinker is quite a task already. Out of the 7 billion, you can probably select out 6 billion. But there is a third component, the high level of execution, that is the ability to perform, to deliver. These are the 3 screens through which we put a lot of people who come in at the entry level, and it's a funnel, and it's just a very small proportion of the overall number of people that pass all 3 filters. Such people are few and far between. They have to be identified early from kindergarten age through school and through university and trained. Typically, it's not just any one competence, but a number of them. So you mean we have to identify them and train them? Yes, and invest in them, and invest in educational technologies that would help that. Mr. Lucas Carlos, what is the proportion between adoption of digital technologies and adopting in people and investing in people? What is more important in your view, technologies or the human component?
Sean, let me illustrate with a real-world example some of the very nice principles which were put forward by Philippe. When I was director of the Global Indicators Group at the World Bank over a period of several years, one of the indicators that we tracked was essentially the tax system in 189 countries. We wanted to know how efficiently these tax systems were actually operating in terms of their ability to collect revenue and to empower the government, you know, to do public policy. And one of the things that we noticed is that sometime around 2003, 2004, the use of the latest technologies began to be sort of universal in many, many of the member countries of the IMF and the World Bank. And in particular, countries started to using the latest technologies to allow for the payment of taxes online. And this, of course, was a welcome development, but it had vast implications. For instance, we noticed was that revenue collection improved. It is much more difficult to cheat on your taxes if you are a business head when you actually have to operate through a very transparent electronic platform than if you have to meet with a tax official, you know, in your office, in an environment that is perhaps not very open. Furthermore, as revenue improved, it allowed governments in many parts of the world to actually lower taxes, which was a good thing, because in many countries, taxes were so high that they were creating all kinds of perverse incentives. We were noticing that the underground economy was growing. Mm-hmm. tax rates often were very high and revenue collection was very low. And so for us, this was a very encouraging story, an example of how the adoption of technologies can actually have real-world consequences for the efficiency of the public sector and for empowering governments to collect revenue so that they can invest in education, they can invest in public health, they can invest in infrastructure. The second point I wanted to make, in my earlier call for improving the quality of public policies and, for instance, eliminating energy subsidies, I was thinking that, of course, as you shift resources away from wasteful spending, you have more resources to invest in education. The ability for the labor force to use the latest technologies is directly linked to our ability to develop new skills in the population, young people, the workforce, and so on. Countries that have invested heavily in higher education especially, I'm thinking of Finland, I'm thinking of Korea, I'm thinking of Taiwan, I'm thinking of Israel, although there are many others, are countries that have improved the capacity of the economy to innovate, are countries that have very quickly shifted, you know, to the technology frontier. I want to mention, just take advantage of this opportunity to say that one of the most impressive examples for me of how online tax payments transform the tax system is Russia. To go back to your reference to my 1990s experience, I remember my first meeting at the State Tax Service in the 1990s. I don't think I remember seeing a computer there. The last time I visited the State Tax Service a few years ago, located on Niglinaya, it was a 21st century building. I mean, it was really most impressive, had nothing to envy some of the most advanced state tax services which I have visited in any other parts of the world, including very high-income countries. And so for me, this was a very, very encouraging story of how in this country, in Russia, the authorities, the private sector, the business community, civil society have actually joined forces and have made very effective use of the digital technologies to enhance the quality of public services. In this particular case, you know, how to pay taxes.
If I'm not mistaken, Mr. Kudrin was one of the authors of the tax system in Russia as it exists today. I mean, our host. Thank you very much. Mr. Sobyanin, I want to pass on this question to you as somebody who is in charge of this huge metropolis of Moscow. How does new technology resonate with such activities as poverty reduction and so on? Well, the answer to that is quite clear. It has always been like that. The countries that lead the world in science and technologies happen to be the richest countries. And the countries that fall behind in technologies are the poor ones. Information technologies are no different. Perhaps even to a larger degree, it's true of them. Because added value stays wherever human capital works best and where new technologies are implemented. Today, it's information technologies. The cost of automobiles, for instance, largely depends upon information technologies. Today, an automobile would not simply drive on the road if you take away all the computer power. And it's not so important where the wheels are produced and where the body is welded together. It's about where the new information technologies are invented and installed. So added value becomes concentrated wherever new technologies appear and develop, and that's where riches flow to. That can drive some inequality, but information technologies are in fact a democratizing factor. They allow more people access to social services. Think about remote medicine or increasing labor productivity or the quality of medicine, for instance. Quality medicine is becoming accessible to larger and larger numbers of people, independent of where they live. The same about distance or internet-based education. People have access to high-quality education independent of where they live and what school they go to. For instance, in Moscow, we have what we call electronic school that's online. School. It's a platform that is open not just to all schools in Moscow, but to all schools in Russia and all schools anywhere in the world. And teachers can share their best experience, and students have access to the best quality teaching wherever they live. And this is something about access to social services. But think about that private tutor who will lose their job of privately tutoring an individual student. Look, that's what progress is all about. New technologies are implemented, but unemployment is not on the rise, not in Moscow, not in Russia. We have the same unemployment levels as we had in 2010. Our unemployment level is 0.3%, 0.5 at the most. 1 million new jobs were created in the past few years in Moscow. Large cities are not pestered by unemployment because of new technologies. Mr. Rozhi, can new technologies address social issues, or what can they do for social policy?
I think the answer is definitely yes, in the sense that, and I think you mentioned a few catastrophes or a number of other sort of social phenomena, which we are obviously all very well aware of and which are all around us. We believe at Microsoft that unless we demonstrate the benefits of this technology in that area, we are never going to be able to capture the hearts and minds of all other applications of technology. And therefore, we are spending a significant amount of time, energy, and focus on identifying a number of opportunities in which we can work on inclusion of people with disabilities. We work on, we put our technology to the good to predict weather patterns and be able to warn people of flooding. We have other projects in the sort of the climatological era where we're looking at how to basically protect civilians in specific countries. We are working on immunization of people when it comes to specific mosquito outbreaks. And so these are all seemingly very random examples, and we have a fund. And by the way, if there are great ideas to, we even offer grants in a program we call AI for Good. We have 300 projects ongoing right now, so if there are any great ideas, please find your way to your local Microsoft representative. But I think they go to show that the use of technology is really also there, maybe short of economic stimuli, which is why we obviously have these grants, to tackle some of the world's most significant problems. And I think with the computing power and the artificial intelligence technology that's out there today, we have to demonstrate that even at the smallest level, these technologies can actually be used for the good. And needless to say, we all hear horror stories from time to time about how technology is being used in ways which, honestly, I don't think any of us would support or condone. But so going out of our way to make sure we build coalitions with some of our industry peers to go and solve real-world social challenges that we have today is absolutely at the forefront of what we try to do. Again, we hope that this is a call to invitations from for many of our colleagues in the industry, because we do believe that ultimately, unless we tackle some of these fundamental challenges, I wouldn't call them catastrophes yet. There are a few, but if we don't act, obviously, I think we will live to regret it. So we are very focused on that as well, and we're spending tremendous resources on it. So I think the answer is yes.
Спасибо. Спасибо. Обращайтесь.
Thank you very much. Go to your local Microsoft office, you said. That was a bit of advertising. Mr. Lopez Carlos, my next question is for you. Is it possible to build an effective system of management or public administration on a global scale, and what can information technologies do for that?
Let me, if I may, just address a couple of issues that were raised by Philippe. That have to do with, you know, the ability of the latest technologies to help us address questions of poverty, of inequality, of employment. The last World Development Report at the World Bank was actually focused on the future of jobs. And in the context of that work, there was a survey done asking experts, you know, whether they thought that the new technologies would be job-creating or job-destroying. And the results were fascinating. Half said that they were job creating, half said that they were job destroying. I myself find that I am in the more optimistic camp. I think that there are many potential benefits associated with, you know, sort of this current pace of technological growth and improvement. For instance, technology, I think, is going to allow us to have a more flexible labor market, which will allow us to especially focus on the young, on women, on the elderly, which is where many of the pockets of need and unemployment and poverty are located. The latest technologies also will allow us to create new occupations. You know, when you look at the data, for instance, the United States, during the last 40 years, 50% of all job creation has been in new jobs which did not exist before. And then I would also say that the technologies can help us do a better matching between the jobs that are available in the market and the jobs that are actually being demanded by the private sector. At the moment, one of the problems that we have with unemployment is there is a very poor matching system between what is needed and what is offered. And then finally, I think that the latest technologies can also help us better identify who the poor are in a particular country. Our public policies, especially our social policies, are not very well targeted. Very often, the benefits are not really going to the people who actually need them. And this actually is an area where we could do a lot more work. On your question, look, I think that one of the challenges that we face is that we need to change our mental framework. Essentially, you know, we're coming out of a period of many decades where our public policies have been based very much on the notion of national sovereignty. And now, because most of the problems that we face are global in nature, I think we need to basically develop this consciousness that we are essentially an integrated global economy, an integrated community of nations that are facing all of these complex challenges, and that we need to work together. And this has to be on the basis of cooperation. This means improving the efficiency of our multilateral institutions, because they are the ones who are going to be doing the heavy lifting when it comes to dealing with inequality, with climate change, and so on. And then also, I like to emphasize, we need to do much more in terms of improving the quality of our educational systems. You know, we have been very successful in the last 50 years in reducing illiteracy, in increasing school enrollment rates at every level. But now the challenge is basically, you know, how do we strengthen the skills capacity and the skills levels of the population? How do we empower people to be able to use the latest technologies, you know, meaningfully and in a way that will contribute to economic growth?
Господин Лопес Кларес.
Mr. Lopes Claris, coming to conclusions of your speech, how do you think one can always remain ready for a change? What communities should do where the hierarchy is the foundation for operations like the Supreme Audit Institutions and Auditors Community? There is a very clear hierarchy, clear and solid standards. How they can possibly adopt to this change?
I want to give you a historical example, and I want to make a proposal to conclude. You know, the historical example is goes back to 1948. You know, in 1948, the General Assembly, which is meeting as we speak today, issued a declaration called the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It was approved by 48 countries. No country opposed it. And although it was a declaration and it was not binding in character, what happened over the next several decades is that it proved to be a very important source for law and for practice in the area of human rights. All right? So that's the history. Now, going forward, I don't know whether you are aware that a few months ago, the Secretary General of the United Nations established a panel on digital cooperation. It was chaired by Melinda Gates and by Jack Ma. And they issued a declaration of digital interdependence, where they lay out, a little bit like in 1948, you know, a set of universal principles that we can all endorse. They lay out a set of principles which are supposed to guide the use and the development of digital technologies over the next several years and decades in a way that will contribute to economic sustainability and environmental sustainability, in a way that will allow us to reduce poverty, to empower people, and so on. What I like to suggest, and I do this with humility, Mr. Kudring, it would be wonderful if this meeting and the audit institutions all over the world were actually to endorse this declaration. I assure you, the principles are noble, they are high-minded, they're all very, very positive. And I myself will be encouraging business community heads and civil society organizations to take on this digital, this declaration of digital independence, and to put it very much in the forefront of policy discussions over the next several decades.
Алексей Ильинич, получится?
Mr. Kudrin, will you be able to take a look at the declaration? Well, I think we all be willing to read into the wording of this declaration and see how we can use it in our daily work. Thank you very much, Mr. Kudrin, joined us in the discussion. That is wonderful. The same question to you, Mr. Roger. Coming to conclusions, how do you think, what is your recipe, how corporations and communities can always remain ready for change?
I believe a lot of very valid points have been made today. I think the opportunity that the technology provides is clear. We, as a technology, as a representative of the technology sector, I think we understand the responsibility which is on our shoulders. And I think that really, for me, is the balance between the two. Ultimately, it's in the hands of others to embrace, to see opportunity, to put to good. I think we will continue to contribute to some of the driving factors that I pointed to in the beginning when it comes to literacy, when it comes to putting this technology to trustworthy use and defining ethical principles around the use of artificial intelligence, as we have very publicly, and we're inviting our industry friends to contribute. When it comes to using this type of artificial intelligence for good, which is the program I just referred to before, I think there's still a lot of shaping has to happen, but I think with the right set of principles, I think we can go build a coalition across technology and into society to really see this as an opportunity to tackle some of our most fundamental challenges. and unlock, I think, a level of societal change, which will be, as was pointed out, which will be more inclusive, which will create opportunities, and I think will benefit all of us.
Спасибо.
Thank you very much, Mr. Greff. Over to you. What do the hierarchy-like structures can do to adapt to this change? What is your recipe? What type of hierarchies do you mean? International organizations? Well, I've just cited the Supreme Audit Institutions. Well, I cannot really comment on the audit institutions. As for international organizations like the IMF, they are to die and cease to exist because they are not able to have the sufficient level of self-identification, and they're not ready to go through the necessary reforms. We've been talking about long enough, and many people are just feeding themselves on those endless empty conversations. I believe the IMF is a dead body. Well, thank God in 2000, we've spent a lot of time on negotiations with the IMF, and luckily, we have not followed their advice. The IMF demanded that we increase the tax burden. The tax burden back then was 41% of the GDP, and they wanted us to increase the tax burden even higher. Luckily, we quit those negotiations. We paid out our debt to IMF, although back then it was extremely hard. And my only advice to other organizations, do not become dependent from the IMF. Because the IMF does not follow the disrupt technologies, they follow the recipes of the yesterday, they will be bring no God to you. And unfortunately, the same can be said about many other international organizations. So we are talking about digital technologies, and we repeat them like some kind of a prayer. Well, dear colleagues, we need to talk about introduction of digital technologies, of course, but we also need to understand that we seem to fall into the following trap. You talk about poverty. Well, digital technologies bring us to the fact that the scale of poverty is growing and the gap between different countries is growing. The gaps between different companies having technologies and do not having technologies is also increasing. The gap in the level of income between individuals who have possessions and command and knowledge of technologies and those who do not have it is growing as well. So we need to talk about the problem of total monopolism that digital technologies bring us to. Now we've been talking about Microsoft. 80% of all operational systems on computers, oh, sorry, not 80, it is even around 90% of all operational systems are Microsoft Windows. Tiny share goes to Linux and Mac, but more than 80% for sure goes to Microsoft. And if we talk about social media, well, Facebook has 75% of the global market, or search engines market, 90% goes to Google. If we remove 3 to 4 countries that have their own national search engines, like South Korea, Japan, Russia, and China, in all the remaining countries, the share of Google goes to 100%. That is a serious problem, and this technological gap is constantly growing. So I think we should also discuss those aspects. We are building a new world, and the architecture of this world is becoming quite chaotic. And we are to face new serious challenges because of that. As for the hierarchy-like structures, well, the controlling authorities will be the last one to change. They cannot build anything new because it is some kind of a substructure. If the whole system is following the old processes and paper-based processes, how can you possibly use digital technologies? So it is important that, first of all, the objects of audit are introducing those disruptive processes, and afterwards, it's the supervising and auditing bodies that will be able to change their work modes as well. Mr. Greff, as always, very fair and seems to be very rigid. Those who fail to be efficient will die. Okay, Mr. Sabanian, over to you. I do not agree to what Mr. Greff has said. Well, I think it would. We will die sooner than they will die. The technological changes are very fast. However, changes to the structures of public authorities and public administration are very slow. Many of them have been in existence for hundreds of years and are not willing to change. One might think that new technologies and centralization of huge areas of data, creation of shared platforms, single information systems, would only strengthen this vertical of power, this hierarchy, when from the very top you might send a command or instructions all the way to the bottom. And that is a huge temptation, I would say, to stick to this hierarchy. But it is hardly efficient. Nonetheless, I have to say that there is a big paradox. When new technologies do not destroy the hierarchy of power, but in parallel to that, create parallel systems that enable you to communicate directly to the whole community and create brand new democratic systems of management. Of course, those are abstract ideas and fantasies, but I want to cite a very simple example from urban management. For example, in the past, in order to complain that there is some garbage on the street opposite his house, they would have to send a letter to the managing company. They would wait for a response for a very long time. Then they would submit another complaint to the municipal authorities and again would have to wait. They might send a letter of complaint to another administration, to the householding authority. They would finally send a complaint to the mayor's office and would receive an answer in maybe several years. Now, in the city of Moscow, we have an information system called Our City, and that is a totally transparent public environment where in one click, a person might submit a complaint that would rush all the way through the vertical of power and go back down. And they would receive a response and actually the result to the complaint in the course of 4 days. So it would really rush you through all the hierarchies of power and would provide an immediate response. So probably we all should be optimists. Sometimes, without breaking the existing structures, we can introduce new technologies and create new, alternative, more democratic systems of management. If I may, a short react. Well, when I was saying that international organizations will die, I primarily meant, I think, organizations like IMF, not the governments. If we talk about public administration and state management, well, I would definitely say that in this regard, new technologies would make great competitive advantages for the countries. The only thing that makes one country different from another is the efficiency of public administration. There are countries with high efficiency of public administration. They demonstrate great results. And there are countries that have inefficient, non-transparent public administration system, which results in poverty and deterioration. This process will become even stronger. And the efficiency of public administration, as I said, the first revolution in public administration is high on the agenda, and we will see it whether we like it or not, because the speed of differentiation will be increasing. Dear colleagues, thank you very much for the discussion. Indeed, everything we've been discussing today, all those tools and instruments will enhance successful development in the age of disruption. And our colleagues from the Supreme Audit Institutions are working on this week in Moscow.
For your opinions, for discussion, it was great. Thank you.